got people that are ready to join us, and so if you just want to find your spot today, we'll get going. One of the things we know is, as we come here this morning, we recognize it's about Jesus. Amen? And so, no matter what's going on, no matter what's happened already in your day, we know that it's about Jesus right now. Lord, we just come to this time and we ask that you would just settle our hearts, Lord. And Lord, help us just to stop again on this day that you've asked us to put aside time. You've asked us to put aside time to think on you and to recognize you. And we just want to do that today. We pray that you would just right now lead our hearts and guide us as we seek you. And we pray, Lord, that this time would be pleasing in your eyes. And we pray, Lord, that you would just help us to see you. And that you would help us to see ourselves, Lord, as you see us. And, Lord, we just pray that you would just be glorified in this time. Your people say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. We're just going to glorify him. Marcy's coming, and she's going to be leading us in play in our songs. And let's just let our hearts just reach out to him today and make that connection. You want to do that? So let's just make that connection.
Are you ready to worship together this
Amen.
Morning?
Yes.
All right, would you guys stand with us for this first song?
Thank you.
So
Starting a new one That's going to start this next week on Monday, and it's called Courage. And it will a week from Monday. Yes, sorry. A week from tomorrow, this study will be starting. And it's called Take Courage, and it's a study on the book of Haggai. And it's interesting. I love how the books of the prophets are just more alive than ever today when we see what their message was. And so you want to be a part of that. Let God's word shine on you in that. And also, we just remind you there are some lines in the back when you leave today, and we take advantage of that. There's a little bit. Our farmer's market has been a little bit crazy with COVID, and we've had some food for you here and there, but we just want to make you aware of that. Let's pray as we start this morning. Lord, we just pray right now, again, for you to settle our hearts and help us to think on you. Lord, that we would just take time to reflect and to look, and that you would help us, Lord, to take an honest look today. Lord, a genuine look, and not just for the sake of being in church. Lord, we pray that you would just speak to us in the way only you can do. And Lord, we ask you to lead us now in your word. Amen. I wanted to dress up for you. I hate dressing up in all my costumes. But if I could, I would have dressed up in a costume and maybe wore a robe or something and a big sign that just said, repent. Have you seen that? You seen that evangelist on the road before?
Yes,
ma'am. And the messages were just, repent. And there was a Christian comedian years ago. He would tell a story. He would kind of describe what it must have been like for the first Ninevite to see Jonah. He said, I can imagine Jonah. He's in the belly of a whale. Have you ever smelled even like somebody's tackle box out in the sea? Because this guy's in the belly of a whale for 3 days. He's in the juices, and the acid must have worn his clothes off. He don't even have anything left in his hair. If he had any, it would have been maybe bleached and standing straight up, or who knows what he looked like and smelled like. And can you imagine the first one he walks up to and he goes, repent. That person's like, man, I don't want to be like him. I want to do something. And the message of repent, I'll see about it. It seems like maybe it's like that's kind of an odd message to preach to a church. We think of that as the message, again, of the guy on the street or the evangelistic outreach need, the people. We're trying to reach somebody and they've never heard it. So what's the message? Well, the message is repent, and we think that they need that message and we don't. And I think that's why we need that message today, is because God says, I want you to repent. And so we're going to start here in the book of Revelation, a passage that we've read before. It's pretty familiar to you. It's to the church in Revelation chapter 3. And I'm just going to read a part of this, not the whole thing, starting with verse 17. As again, he's not talking to the crowds. He's not talking to the messed up culture. He's not talking to your neighbor who hates God. He's talking to the church when he says this. And this is Jesus' message to the church, by the way. He said in verse 17, you say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and listen to this line, and I do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich. And white clothes to wear so that you can cover your shameful nakedness. And salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Now listen to this. Those whom I love, what? I rebuke and I discipline. So be earnest and repent. Well, a message to the church, he's saying. Us, be earnest today. As we look at his word today, can I challenge you to that? To be. Not just, whatever he said, or we kind of were there. He says, be earnest today to hear from God and his message to us, to the church, is repent. Pretty powerful message. I was thinking about the message and one of the greatest preachers ever, John the Baptist. You know, Zechariah, his dad, was given a prayer, and he was, it says that the Holy Spirit filled him, and you know what he said? He says, my son is going to be the light, the way, making the way for Messiah. The light of the world, talking about forgiveness of sins. Then it begins to talk about John's ministry, and you know what it says? His message was? His message was baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. Where does the road to Jesus start? It starts with repentance. He says it starts when we recognize we need him. And he's talking to not just people who are those people. He says, I'm talking to you. And I want us, I'm trying not to say it a bunch today, but maybe as we're here today, that you can say it to yourself, because he's talking to me. Not me. He's talking to me. Like, God's talking to me. Well, yeah, those other people, maybe, yeah, but he's talking to me. That's where it starts. Is it starts with us. We read about the prayer of Daniel, and Daniel said, God, we have sinned. And so I want to be on that again today, that we recognize that we have that confession. Say, God, we have sinned. So welcome to confession today. Now, when I was a kid, I wish this wasn't on video, because I don't want to offend anybody, but I always wanted to be Catholic, because I thought, what a great religion. You can do anything you want, and then you just go tell them what you did, and you're okay. It's like, I can do that. Like, all the Catholic kids I knew, they could cuss, they could do all kinds of stuff. It's like, it's all right, we just go to confession, and it's good. And in my heart, I kind of thought I wanted to do that, but in my heart, I kind of thought, that doesn't seem right. And of course, I know that's not really the way Catholics believe. I know, well, some of them do, but that's not really the doctrine that they're teaching. But that was my idea. It was like, well, if I just do it, you know, sin is just, it's kind of a thing, and as long as you take care of it, as long as you go and tell God, okay, I did it, then it's taken care of. And God has said, no, you know what? I need you to understand something. That's not repentance. That's not turning. That's not leading you to God. That's just religion. He says, I need you to recognize, first of all, recognize what a state you're in and turn to me. I heard some people recently that were really excited about it. There was a preacher, and he had six COVID and some stuff, and he was getting a lot of attention, but one of the things he preached on sin, and people were like, man, that was a great message, how he preached on sin, you know. And I was like, yeah, that's really good, you know, we need that. A lot of people say, yeah, we need that. That's kind of, yeah, we need that. Maybe I should do that. And it's like, he said, well, you need to preach on your sin, not just pointing at other people's sin. Oh, but I like to preach on other people's sin. Well, don't you like it? I mean, we look at our culture, and what do we do? We say, look at how godless they are. Look at what's happening. And it's true. But what do you expect godless people to do? They're going to be godless. And we want to, it's like, wow, we need to be hard on sin. It's like, yes, we do. And the mirror's right there. And I'm not talking to you. That's you. I'm talking to me. It's like, well, sometimes I make it pretty light. Well, you know, but I haven't done anything horrible. Well, you know, maybe get nervous if I talk about sin. Well, this pastor's going to confess something. Okay, I've been taking millions of dollars from the church. But no, I don't have some giant thing to confess. I don't have something. But you know what? I'm a wretch. I look at it like, God, I am so desperate in need of you. I don't have it together any more than the people that I see in our society that are godless. The only way I can have you is when I recognize my absolute need for you. And so, why would you preach a message on repent? Because I need to repent. And what do I think we need as a church? I said, well, we need to repent. And not just like, well, we kind of throw that in and we say, if we do this, you know, here's the formula, we repent. And then we do. He's like, no. Like, really. Like, God, we need you. God, we have sinned. And we'll look a little bit, maybe talk about David's prayer a little bit later, but David's prayer in Psalm 51. He says, oh God, I have sinned against you. I'm wicked, he said. I need you. That we would have that heart today. I was thinking about our current situation again in our culture, in our area, in America, in California. And I thought, how many people want to see revival? How many of you? Who doesn't want to see revival? We love to see that. We love to see things change. And I thought about one of the revivals in the Bible was the revival that happened when Jonah preached in Nineveh. And I don't know the exact numbers. You know, a lot of times we have something, they say, well, this many people did this and that. We don't know. And Jonah didn't have a little report in the book of Jonah. But the Bible says that there was at least 120,000 people there that were hearing the message that God was concerned about. So what if we had a revival here and 120,000 people said, we recognize that God is God. We want to turn. We've been wrong. And 120,000 people turned to God and were calling on him. And we see that account in the book of Jonah. But the interesting thing about the book of Jonah that we a lot of times forget is that who's the star of the book of Jonah? God is the one, and we see this great picture of God, and what's he like in the book of Jonah? He's patient. Is that an understatement? That God was patient? Mm-hmm. Patient with the Assyrians, those people that have nothing to do with God, that were out to get God's people, that hated them. He was patient with Jonah. He went the other way. He was kind. He cared. He cared about Jonah. He cared about the Assyrians. He's all powerful. He was able to do anything. There was nothing that was out of his control or out of his power. There was nothing that could keep him from reaching the Assyrians, even a prophet that's taken off the other direction. There was nothing that could stop God. So all these things about God, and even, this is to me one of the most amazing, is he was even willing to work in the lives of people who had nothing to do with it. I've told you before, one of the hardest things for me is he's the God that loves the ungrateful. He was reaching out to people who weren't reaching out to him. And he was even using a preacher that wasn't reaching out to him. In fact, he was running the other way. And he was upset with God. That's what God's like. And I don't know about you, but I begin to read that, and I think the title of the book of Jonah might be, Don't Be Like Jonah. Don't be a Jonah. Jonah didn't listen to God. He didn't see it from God's perspective. He didn't have any kind of gratitude, did he? Jonah wasn't thankful. We've been talking about how thankfulness just is in our... That's a part of what God wants us to be and who we are, that we're constantly, what? Recognizing him. And Jonah wasn't grateful. He wasn't grateful about God's patience with him. He didn't let that change him. He wasn't even grateful. Think about this. Jonah was born a Jew. And had God's word and was trained up and knew who God was. What if Jonah had been saying, man, what a blessed man I am. That you gave me your word, that you allow me to know you, that you've allowed me this, and then after all I've done, that you gave me another chance. And Jonah wasn't even grateful for the shade God. Man, the older I get, the more I'm grateful for shade. I got long hair up here. I need shade. We were sitting there, we had lunch just the other day. My dad's here, we got to go and we had lunch, and we were all squeezed in the shade. Why? It's important. And he's like, Jonah's not even grateful for the shade. He has no compassion on the people of Assyria. And I said, yeah. Am I guilty of Jonah's sins? And God says, yeah. Do you listen, God? I mean, I've got great ideas. I know what should happen. I know what you should do to the state of California. I really know. I mean, I know what you should do. I know what should happen. I know how to fix it. And I pray that way. God, here's what you should do, God. Remember Sodom and Gomorrah. Remember this. Remember that. And it's just let's do them. And I'm ready to do that. And I'm not grateful. And I think I'm grateful, but I'm not. And I don't recognize that. It's God, how much you've given me. And every time I'm down, every time there's something wrong, I go, man, if I just think of what God's given me, it's just embarrassing to even feel sorry for myself. And I want to feel sorry for myself. And I want to just have some time when I say, God, can't you see? And he's like, if you just look at how much I've given you, you're just going to laugh at yourself. Yeah. And God, sometimes I get angry instead of compassion. Sometimes I'm mad about it. And I look at the city, and I look at the state, and I look at our country, and I'm just like, Jonah, I'm sitting up there going, burn, baby. I'm ready for it. Like, God, do it. And I mean, keep me out of it. I don't want to be in it. But besides that, God, it's a mess. And he just, let's just, boom. And God's saying, shouldn't you care that I care? Well, I see the anger from people on both sides of issues. And I say, you know what? God is the one saying, shouldn't you care? They're not saying something's right or it's okay. God didn't say it. No, you just, you know, sin's fine. You know what? Forgive. Let's just forgive about it. You can kind of do that. He said, no, you need to do what? You need, what was Jonah's message? Repent. His message was repent. Turn from that. And turn to me. Well, I like to look at their sin. I like to say, I'm happy to point at Nineveh and see how they were wrong. They were wrong. They were godless. They were out to get the Jews. They were people that didn't have any regard for God at all. But I have to tell you this. It's a lot easier for me to preach to Nineveh if I don't have a plank in my eye. Remember what Jesus said? He says, oh yeah, you want to help them, but what? You got a plank in your own eye. And you don't even see it. And I don't know about you, but I say, like, Jesus, you're going a little overboard. I mean, I've got maybe a little pebble in my eye. But not a plank. I love that Jesus said, like, you think you're okay? He goes, you got a plank in your eye. Like, no. I mean, who couldn't know they had a plank in their eye? Right? And Jesus said, you. That's what I feel like. Jesus, like, no. You know, Jesus, you're making too big a deal about it. You're making it sound like I'm just some real evil person. Like I'm as bad as them. And he goes, you got this plank that is so big. And even for me today, it's kind of an awkward thing because I feel like I want that message to be for you, but it's like the message is not that I can like go tell your church to repent. It's like, go tell yourself to repent. And you have to be the one to say, my Lord, me, I do it. And you realize that when we really get into God's presence, when we really see God, what happens? We recognize that we need to repent. I love the fact that you know Peter led a pretty good revival too in the early church and the things that were happening. It wasn't as pretty, and there were there were a lot of troubles and there were a lot of things, but I love to think about Peter's start. We like to pick on Peter and all the bad things that he's done, all the dumb things he said and all those things. But one of the things I love, when Peter was first called, and you know, Jesus is there, and Jesus says, I need you to use your boat, let's go out on the lake. And so Jesus is teaching. It's funny, it says Jesus was teaching the Word of God. He was the Word of God, he's got that authority, and Peter's listening, and the disciples that are going to follow him are listening. And he goes in, and when Jesus finishes, he says, okay, why don't you cast your nets on this side of the boat? And they do that, and what happened? Just loads and loads of fish. And Peter's been listening to God's word. He sees what Jesus does, and you know what his response was? He goes, you got to get out of here. He goes, because I'm a sinful man. Peter immediately recognized something. What? I don't deserve you. Like you're gonna know what I'm like. And if you want me to follow you, what's gonna happen? How would you like to be Jesus' disciple? We always talk about that. We always talk about, wouldn't it be great to be Jesus' disciple? Yeah. He's gonna know everything about you. He's gonna know your habit. I mean, he already does, but like, you know. We always laugh. Well, that Pastor Ron, he's so nice. I just laugh, you know, because it'd be like, no, he's a real person. He's got real issues and problems, just like you got. But and I know you guys are smarter than that. You know that. But there's some people that's like, oh, he's a pastor. He always is nice. He always thinks good thoughts. He just, you know, something comes up and he's just kind of like, oh yeah, you know. Peter's like going, man, you better get away from me, Jesus. Why? Because I see what I'm like. The call of a few of the prophets, and notably, we always know, you know, what did Isaiah say? Since he sees God in a vision, what does he say? Woe is me. Man, the stuff that comes out of my lips, out of my heart, it's not right. And, oh yeah, and the people I live with too. Man, God, I says, I want you to look at yourself. Jesus seemed to be concerned with the spiritual community. He sees the people, and I think it's interesting. In Luke chapter 5, I'm just going to read a couple of verses, but I'll tell you the story. Jesus is, again, this is after he's been calling disciples, and their people are following him, and his ministry is just kind of starting. And he calls Levi, the tax collector. And of course, you know, just from culture, I think pretty much you have a pretty good idea. They were hated. I mean, we hate tax collectors now. This was even more. They were like traitors. So they were worse than saying, you know, if you're a Republican, saying you're a Democrat. If you're a Democrat, saying you're a Republican. So this was even way beyond that. This was like, you know, he's a hated guy. And he's got these people that he's hanging out with, and they're the worst of the worst, and they're the low life, and the religious community, the leaders, the Pharisees, those that are, and again, they're trying to do right, at least some of them. And they look at it, and they see this happen, and it says in chapter 5, it says that Levi had a great banquet. He was excited because Jesus had called him and had been there for him. And it says, and they sat at Jesus' house, and a large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating with them. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, who belonged to that group, to that sect, complained to his disciples, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And then Jesus is concerned with their attitude. And he'll, in other times, in other places, he'll be directing statements to them because he's worried about their attitude. But here it's really clear. It says, and Jesus answered them, he said this, it's not the healthy who need the doctor, but who? It's the sick. He said, I haven't come to call the righteous, or I like to say those who think they're righteous, but sinners to what?
Repentance.
To repentance. Yeah. Again, he says, to a feeling, not just to, you know, this grace is great grace, but then it's not just out there gonna, he says, that you turn and say, oh, I need you. He says, I've come to call those who are sick, those can we all have COVID? Because that seems like something that I've heard about a little bit lately. So pretend we all had COVID. And Dr. Jesus comes in here, and he's willing to heal anyone with COVID. But there's some of us, now I would never do this, but there's some of us that would be like, you know, as soon as he comes in, like, I'm going to pretend like I'm not sick. Like, hold that cough in. I'm going to put a cough drop, you know, I don't want to, I'm going to sit here, and I'm going to just try to pretend like I'm not sick, because it's embarrassing. Everybody's going to know that I'm sick, and they're going to know that I need that. And even though the answer is right there, we're all going to sit in here and pretend like we're not sick. Do you want to do that spiritually? And then we all do, like, let's just pretend like we got it all together. Let's just pretend like we're all right, like we're good. Like, I know other people need Jesus more than me. I just need a little Jesus. And I'm going, like, Jesus is going, here's what I want you to understand. Here's what he's saying to them. He goes, you are sick. He's telling them, and he's basically, these are people that would be like leaders in the synagogue, which is very similar to what we would do in church. They get together, you know what they did? They got together and they talked about God's word. And they talked about, wow, it's like, those are the people. And Jesus said to them, you know what? You're a bunch of sick people. You need a doctor. You need healing. And these guys over here, they're like, they know it. They're like at the emergency room going, hey, please let us in. We're sick. And they're coughing all over everything, and he goes, they're going to get medicine. But you don't even know that you're sick. Jesus was real concerned with that. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to miss out on medicine. He said there's a lot of people that are running around, again, just, you know, because we've maybe heard this talk about this. There's a lot of people that are asymptomatic with sin. We pretend like, well, yeah, and we are infected by it all. Jesus talked about it when he talked to the leaders again another time. He said, hey, you are beautiful on the outside. Because you look so good. But he said, inside, you are rotten and dead and sleepy. Because, man, there's a problem there. I don't want to miss out on that. I don't want to be the one in myself to say, Jesus, I really don't need you. Again, going back to David's prayer, I love his prayer. He says, God, I've sinned against you. In fact, he said, God, I've been sinful since the time I was a baby. He wasn't even trying to just like, you know, I would be saying like, God, well, let me tell you, here's some of the good things I've done. I mean, I know I did this, and I know I'm kind of in need of you right now, but let me just tell you, David's like, you know what, everything, and he says, I want you to do a work in me. And I love this. We sing it in the song sometimes. It says, and you take not your Holy Spirit from me and restore the joy of your salvation. We talked last week a little bit about weeping. We talked about these. And that's part of repentance, is that man, God, I've grieved you. I'm sad. I don't just like take that lightly. That God, that I'm serious about that. That it hurts. And yes, I see some things in my world that are hurting, but when I realize that I'm the cause of that, Lord, that I have fallen short, that grieves me. And he says, when you have that heart, you're in the place for God to pick you up. When we try to do it ourselves, when we try to say, oh, I'm okay, you know, I know God will be okay with this sin. I know God will be okay. I know I haven't been perfect, but God will be okay with it. He says, you're missing. But when we say, oh, God, I've hurt you. I don't deserve your salvation. He says, then I'm there to pick you up. One of the verses we love, especially in times like this, we talk about 2 Chronicles 7:14. We love that promise. It's a beautiful verse. verse. But it does say this. It says, if my people will do what? Humble themselves and call on me and seek me and do what? Turn from their wicked ways. Then I'll make for them. James says this, that humble yourself before the Lord and what? Then he will lift you up. Not say like, okay, I'm all right. He says, no, you humble yourself and let God lift you up. And we're in that place where we say, God, I need to recognize the seriousness of sin. You want a message on sin? Well, it's not to just sit and lambast the world and talk about all the way the culture's going downhill. And it is. I understand that. There are problems. There are issues. It is messed up out there. And it is sad. But if we want a message on sin, maybe we need to start with saying, my God, let me be grieved about my sin. Let me be grieved about my lack of compassion, my lack of thanking you, my lack of recognizing you. Lord, that I've been like Jonah. Lord, help me be a little bit more like Peter that said, God, I don't even deserve you to be here. I'm a sinner. Get away from me. And Jesus picked Peter up, didn't he? And he picked him up again later. And he picked him up more. He says, I want you to humble yourself. 1 John 1:9 says,
if you confess your sins,
then he's faithful and just. That means saying, God, I recognize my sin. That word for confession, we've talked about a little before, but I love the root of that, but it's basically saying, you see it like God sees it. Not like I see it, not, but you say, God, you're right. I was wrong. I recognize it. If we confess our sin, not justify our sin, not take our sin lightly, not say, oh, well, he paid for it, it's all right, I don't have to worry about it. The book of Hebrews, you know, a big part of the book of Hebrews was saying, you know what, if God was serious about it when he gave the law, he goes, how much more serious is he about it when he gave his precious life for you? If he was serious about sin in the Old Testament when he gave his law, if he was serious about that, that's what the writer of Hebrews said. He goes, how much more when he's given his life, his only son, Jesus, for you. But I don't want to be the one to say, well, you know, it doesn't really matter. I mean, I'm pretty good. I've not done horrible things. I haven't, you know, we had a famous president that once said, well, I didn't inhale. And I feel like, you know, as funny as that is, but I feel like I do that with my sin. Say, well, God, I didn't inhale. Well, have you ever read the Sermon on the Mount or Jesus' teaching? He says, hey, listen, you're way off. Mm-hmm. He says, I want you to confess your sins. He says, the message to the church, what? You are poor and wretched and pitiful and naked, blind. So, what? Be earnest and repent. So, what's our message today? Repent. Are you kidding? I can take those signs up? No, for us today, repent. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Lord, we don't want to take lightly your word today. And Lord, say, well, that's nice. And I kind of agree with the point you said that if we hear your word and we don't live it, that we're like a fool. And our life's going to be destroyed. Lord, we pray that you would help us, Lord, to hear your words, Lord, to hear your word to us, and that we would put it in our life, that we would build our life, Lord, that we would listen, that we would hear, Lord, that we would be in tune with you and not just justify ourselves. And Lord, it's not that someone else is going to tell us what's right or wrong. It's not someone else's job to do that, Lord, but that you have convicted us, your Holy Spirit, today. We ask you to heal us. Lord, we pray that you would make us whiter than snow. Lord, we pray that you would search our hearts and You're just, you're compassionate, you're our God, you're our Messiah, you're our hope. And we pray that you would help us to find you today. Help us to repent, Lord, we ask it in your name. Would you stand with me this morning? I'm going to end it with a little bit of a different way. I want to sing a song a cappella. And I didn't even give them the words because I'm pretty sure you've heard of this one. It's called Amazing Grace. And Amazing Grace, I love it because it's, what's not to love about Amazing Grace? It's a great tune. You know, musically, it's a really good tune. And it's kind of an interesting thing. Music-wise, you know, people can put, like, all kinds of things to it, you know, and you can sing it. The tune, and everybody knows the tune. And even when we did like community guitar lessons, one of the things I could do is like people would never have heard a church song in their life, but they knew Amazing Grace. And we love that song, and not only that, but when we sing it in church, we're like, oh, I love that song. It's got some emotion to it, you know, and it means something to you, and we sang that my whole life. I knew that grandma sang that and all those things. And even though we know the words, it just kind of becomes a song because of the song. I want to sing it just one time as we leave, and we'll just sing it a cappella. And just because I love that says, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I just gloss over that every time. You know, I kind of like, I know what the song's about, but I don't always, you know. And today, I just want that song to be so meaningful to us. Not because it's sentimental, and not because, you know, we know it and it touches that. I'm glad it does all those things, but let's just sing it because we're saying, like, oh, Amazing Grace that God would save a wretch like me. Thank you for this time. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.